Hi, this is what we're working on today. So we have this character who can move up, down, left, and right, and has an attack animation for each of those directions. If you've ever used a similar sprite, you probably have a setup like this, where we grab the last facing direction, convert it to a string, and then play an animation based on what we're doing. And today, we're going to recreate it using an animation tree. So the first thing we'll do is go ahead and add an animation tree. The animation tree needs to know about our animation player, so we'll go ahead and assign that. And then we have to decide what tree root we want to use. The tree root can be as simple as a blend space, or it can be as complex as multiple nested state machines. We're going to build up as we go, so let's start with something a bit simpler. First, we'll recreate the run animation so we can select a blend space 2D. If I click on this, and then open up the animation tree panel, we can see our blend space here. Basically, the way this works is we define animations in this space, and based on which one we're closest to, it'll play that animation. And we can select this tool to add animations. Since we're doing run first, I'll go ahead and add run up, run down, run left, and run right. And that's almost all we need. We can see that if I drag this up here, we're running up, running down, running left, and running right. But there's a small issue that we can't see just yet. See, if we drag this to a midpoint between the animations, it doesn't exactly work. And that's because the continuous blend mode is intended for 3D animations, something where you have animations that can blend between each other. Instead, we want to use one of these two options, either discrete or capture. These two behave very similarly. Discrete makes it so whichever animation you're closest to is the one it plays, but you can see every time we flip between the animation, it'll start from frame 1. Capture is almost the exact same, except it'll start from the same frame that you left off on. But for our case, I'll just use discrete. And of course, we want to set this value through code. So instead of using the old animation, I'll go ahead and detach the script and give it a new one. I'll call this one player animation tree. And first, I'll set up the script like this. So I've just exported the animation tree and grabbed the player. And we can, of course, assign the animation tree by dragging it in. We can go ahead and click on this and see that we have this parameter section. If we want to set those, all we have to do is access the animation tree and call the .set function. And then we can click on this and drag it over into the function. And then all we have to do is assign the variable we want. In this case, I'll just grab the player's velocity and normalize it. And if we open the game, running left and right works. But there's one issue. If we run up, we look down. And if we run down, we look up. And the main reason for this is because in Godot, minus 1 is up, at least in 2D. We can either fix this by flipping the velocity inside of here, or we can just flip the animations in the tree. I prefer to do it in the tree, so I'll go ahead and do that. And that works fine. But what about the idle animation? Well, for that, it would be really nice if we could have a second blend space to choose from. And we're going to do just that. And we're going to switch this over to a state machine, but before I do that, I really don't want to reset up this blend space. So what we can do is we can select it and choose Save As. I'll go ahead and put this in the animations folder as player run blend. Then we can change the root of the tree to a state machine. And if we want to load in our space from before, we can just right click and choose load. Now I'll go ahead and change this to say run. And if we hit the play button, we'll set this as our currently active state. So for a basic overview, the way this works is we can choose to create a transition from start to run. And when we first start the game, we'll go from start to our initial state. We can also add different animation states in here and change between them as we need. So let's go ahead and add a new one. So I'll go ahead and add a new blend space 2D. I'll call this one idle and set this up the same way that we set up the other one. We'll choose discrete and add the idle down, idle up, idle left, and idle right animations. And if we want to test that this works, all we have to do is click the play button and then move our cursor around like so. So how do we move between these states? Well, if I go ahead and draw a transition between run and idle, it'll go immediately. Instead, it would be really nice if we could transition between these based on a condition. So I'll go ahead and select a transition and go under advance and set a condition. We'll just call this idle. Then we'll do the same for run. Create a transition from idle to run and set the advance to run. And we can even test this. If we select the animation tree, we can see that we have conditions now called idle and run. If we turn on idle, it swaps to idle. And if we turn on just run, it'll swap to run. We can also see that now we have a blend space for idle and for run. So we'll need to make a little bit of code change to account for this. So back in our script, I'll go ahead and add another set function and pass in the idle blend space. We'll also need to make a change to this parameter since it's no longer the top level node. So I'll go ahead and get rid of that and drag in the run blend space. And then of course we need to set our conditions. So we can set up idle based on whether we're moving, and then we can call the two set functions. For the first one, we'll pass in idle, and for the second one, we'll pass in run. And one last fix for this is we'll go ahead and save a last facing direction, and if we are moving, we'll set that to the velocity normalized. And instead of passing in the raw velocity, we'll pass in this last facing direction. And that works. We can see that we can idle in our four directions. But it's really annoying to set these parameters separately because they're kind of testing the same thing. Wouldn't it be nice if we could just test the player's velocity inside of the tree? Well, we can. So let's take a look at expressions. So for the first thing, we're going to change this advanced expression base node to the player. And then back inside of the tree, instead of using this condition, we can simply test velocity. So if velocity evaluates to true, we'll go from idle to run. And for here, we can check not velocity. And of course, get rid of the condition. And we no longer have to set these here. and that works perfectly. Expressions are like automatic conditions run against the base node. But of course, we have one more state to add in. So let's go ahead and add a new blend space. I'll call this attack, and I'll set this up the same way. And then back in here, we can transition from either run or idle to attack when the player's attacking variable is true. And for that, that's just a variable I'm storing on the player when we're attacking. And I'll go ahead and do the same for run. And then I'll just choose to go back to idle once we're done attacking. And for that, we can just check not attacking. And then the last thing is to set the blend position for the attack. And then just like that, we have our four direction attack. But of course, that's not the last thing trees can do. Having a state machine of animations is really cool, but what if we wanted to slow all the animations down? With an animation player, you could just set a timescale variable. With an animation tree, it takes a little bit more work. So for our last layer of complexity, we're gonna go ahead and add that. I'll go ahead and save off the state machine like we did with the blend space before. And then we'll set the root node to an animation node blend tree. And this is the most complex of all the nodes. Essentially, you can have a set of the other node types and have those output to whatever animation you want. So for the basic setup, we can simply load in our state machine from before and directly connect it to the output. I'll also rename this player states. And just like when we moved the blend space over before, we also have to update the animations in here. And you can see that all of them belong now to this player states variable, so we can just add that here. And if we open the game, it still works. One of the cool things we can do with this is we can add a timescale node. Then we can connect this to the output and run the state machine through it. So if I want to play all the animations at quarter speed, I can set this to 0.25. And you can see that it runs really slow. And just like any other parameter, we can actually set this through code. And we can do that the same way by adding the set function and dragging it over. So for this one, all the animations are going to play 5 times as fast. Something like that's really useful if you want to change animation speed based on how fast the player's moving. If your animation tree isn't working, make sure the active state is set here. Sometimes it can be really annoying to have this active whenever you're working on something. So you can disable it, and inside of your ready function, you can actually call animationTree.active and set this to true. This is something I do all the time. There are a bunch of nodes that you can play around with, and a bunch of different setups that you can use as well. But as far as animation trees goes, that's the basics. That's about it for now.